Are you trying to use DNA to find somebody who you don't even know who it is? For instance, let's say you're adopted. Let's say that you found that there's an NPE in your line. DNA can help you out, and the website dnaadoption.org has a methodology you can use in order to help you find who these people are. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor's story along the way. Be sure to join our membership if you want to have access to some more information about using DNA with genealogy, as well as lots of other genealogy topics. Today, we're going to be talking about searching for your adoptive ancestors. Now, some people may be stopping right here and saying, well, I don't have any adoptive ancestors, so is this really going to be helpful for me? And the answer is once you check out the website, dnaadoption.org, what you're going to find is that they have lots of resources, not only for people who have been adopted, but also for people who aren't adopted, for people who are just trying to find unknown ancestors. And when you think about it, the problem is really very similar. If you're adopted, you don't know who your biological parents are. If you're just getting into genealogy, there may be cases where you find that you have an adoption in your line, or you just have a NPE in your line, not the parent expected. And now you have to go and search for this unknown person. And the steps you take are largely the same for both cases. The DNA adoption website divides up their steps into three major areas. And so I'm going to create three videos that go over each one of these areas. Each area has four steps for you to take in order to help find and make a connection with these unknown ancestors. The very first area is to test and get information. This is where it all begins. You're going to start with the very first step, which is take a DNA test. If you haven't done this, I would encourage you to research and decide whether or not you want to take a DNA test. As I've mentioned in lots of other videos, DNA is a record of relationships. It is a great tool, particularly for people who have unknown ancestors. There are several options of places you can take a DNA test. Ancestry, 23andMe, MyHeritage, FamilyTree DNA, and LivingDNA all offer DNA tests that can help you find your unknown ancestors. And normally I encourage people to test with Ancestry and 23andMe if you have the money, because those two companies have the largest databases and you can't transfer another test into one of those databases. So by testing with 23andMe and Ancestry, you get in the largest databases and you can use that information to transfer over to other databases. Ultimately, if you have the funds, I would encourage you to test with every company, or at least transfer your DNA information into each one of the company's databases. You don't know where your ancestors may be, and they don't know where you are. So by putting your DNA out there everywhere that's possible, you're going to have a better chance of finding people who might be more closely related to you. The second step that DNA adoption has is to get registered. Now, for people who are just doing research on your family trees and you find that there is an NPE in your ancestry, then this step may not apply to you. But certainly if you are adopted or suspected adopted, or even if you suspect that you might have some ancestors that were adopted, then you want to get registered. There are several places that you can do this. You can do this in the state where the adoption occurred. You can do this in the state that you were born if it's a different state. There are also different websites for adoptees where you can register to let those members know that you are seeking your biological family. One of the largest and oldest organizations for this is the International Soundex Reunion Registry. Now, this is a free website that you can register for. Let me go over to it and show you some of the resources that they have available for you. On the Reunion Registry website, it tells you what their mission is. Now, they are a nonprofit. It does not cost any money to register. And if you would like to donate to this organization, then you can donate, and that is tax deductible in the United States. Their goal is to match up people who are adopted or lost or anything like that in order to create these reunions of these family members. When you register with the ISRR, what you're hoping is that your biological family has also registered. And if that's the case, it may be that nothing else needs to happen and you will be able to be linked up. They've actually had some cases where it was just a matter of the adoptee and the biological family registering, and they were able to match them up just from that registration information. On this website, there are a lot of different resources and information that are going to help you in your search as well. So even if you don't have that initial find from registering with them, they're also going to tell you how you can be able to search to actually find some people who registered who may be there, as well as how just to do a search for your biological family. So make sure you are getting registered wherever you can, and particularly for these websites that are designed specifically for helping adoptees find their biological families. The next step that you want to do is you want to get your official information. Now, your official information is what is on the documents that you can access. So when an adoption takes place, there's actually several different documents. There's the document for the adoption itself. There's going to be a birth certificate. There might be an adoptive birth certificate, which is probably the one that you already have. And there might be some other information. One of the things to be looking for in particular is the non-ID information about your biological parents. Now, this is information that basically can't be used to identify people. So it does not include names, it does not include addresses, but it might include a lot of other information that is going to give you clues later on in your search. So you might have the ages of your parents, you might have occupations, you might have physical descriptions of them, you might have their education level. All of these things can be used in a search for an unknown person. And if you've done any genealogy, you should be able to see how this information might be useful as you pick up more and more clues. One of the things that you can also see if you can find is the original birth certificate. Now, depending on the jurisdiction and particularly the state and what laws were in effect at the time, you may or may not be able to get your original birth certificate. One of the things I would also caution you about is understand that the laws change over time. So if you made an effort to get your original birth certificate 10 or 20 years ago, and because of the laws that was not allowed, go back and look and see if there has been a change in the laws. If so, you may now be able to get access to that original birth certificate. I actually know of a person where this happened in the reverse. They had gotten a copy of their original birth certificate early on in their search, and after it was probably a decade or so, they found out that the law was changed about a year after where they wouldn't be able to get a copy of that now. So, be aware that laws change, and so while you may not be able to get it now, you might be able to get it later, or if you can get it now, get it while you can, because they may change that law later. The other thing that you can try to get is a copy of the adoption record. Now, most court systems and states and jurisdictions don't give these out to the adoptees. In a lot of cases, these records may be sealed for some reason. But it doesn't hurt to ask. It doesn't hurt to do that research. Now, in some cases, you may need to hire an attorney to help you navigate the legal system in requesting that adoption record. But if you can get that information, it's going to provide a lot of detail that's going to help you greatly on your search. Now, the fourth step of this initial information gathering phase is to get information from those who know. Talk to your family members. Talk to not just your immediate family members, but also some of the extended family members. They may know something about that adoption. Now, be aware that in your family, there may be different dynamics where some people may not want to talk about this. Some people may not even know about this. So be prepared for some questions back to you. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is as you're gathering this information, not all of that information is going to be correct. Usually, a lot of the official non-ID information or the information on the birth certificate, the original birth certificate, and the adoptive record is going to be correct. But once we start asking people, there may be some errors in the information they say. I had to know a case where, and this is close in my family, where the person was told about their adoptive mother and where she was from, and they were also told about their adoptive father and that he was in the military and just passing through when the mother and the father had met. Well, it turns out, after doing the research on this and actually narrowing down who the father could be to just three individuals, none of them were in the military. And so that bit of information probably had just crept into family lore because the father was just passing through, and because of the time period, you know, being in the military was a reason for somebody to be passing through an area. But as you're gathering this information, what you want to start to do is you want to start to create a profile of these biological individuals for your biological family. So you have official records and you have the information from others who may know about that. Again, as with any genealogy research, you want to try to back up as much of this stuff with other records as possible. The difficult part with adoptees or NPEs is you don't know who these individuals are, and so you don't know what other records you need to be able to look at just yet. But do the best you can in your initial searching stage and trying to gather this information together. So after you've done these first four steps, you're going to have a lot of information that's going to help you narrow down where you need to be looking. Hopefully, you've found a place, you know a time frame, you might know a little bit of information about the biological mother and about the biological father, and that's going to limit the total pool of people that you need to be looking at and help focus in on just the ones that are going to concern you. Remember, at this point, you may actually not have any definite information on who these individuals are. For some of you who are lucky in this search, you may actually find out just in this information gathering search who the biological mother and father are. So congratulations if this is your case, but if not, there's still more steps that you can do to help aid your search. And these steps have been used to find hundreds and thousands of biological parents for adoptees. Now, if you have any questions about how to search for adoptees, then put it in the comments below. And stay tuned for the next two videos that are going to go over the other steps on the DNA adoption website.